Carol Testament reading this morning comes from the prophet Jeremiah, 23rd chapter, the first six verses. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people, it is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. New Testament reading comes in the Gospel of Luke, the first chapter, 68 to the 79th verse. This is Zechariah's prophecy. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David. As he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors, and has remembered his holy covenant. The oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. A new child will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The preacher on this last Sunday of the church year is given an option. There are actually two suggested gospel lessons. The one is very apocalyptic, you know the type, full of doom and gloom and troubles and wars and pestilence and famine. The world is going to hell in a handbasket. But in that lesson, we are reminded not to fear, because Jesus Christ is Lord. He is our King. He will redeem those things that he will redeem. He will come again. The second option, which I chose for us today, is this prophecy that appears in the Gospel according to Luke. I would have us consider it, and I would have us embrace it as the last word of this last Sunday of the church liturgical year. This prophecy is the prophecy of Zechariah. And surely you all remember who Zechariah is. Well, maybe we need a little review. Correct. Correct. It is, in fact, John the Baptist's father. And the story is told in the scripture that as a priest, it was his time to go to the temple and to perform the priestly service for a season. And faithfully, this old man, Zechariah, went to the temple, which is the seat of God's worship in that ancient time, went to the temple, to the place where God's mercy met humankind's need, and performed his service. And as he's performing his service within the most holy section of the temple, the angel Gabriel appears to him. and says to him, "Old man, priest Zechariah, guess what? You and your wife are going to have a son." They had longed to have a son their entire marriage, but it hadn't occurred. Zechariah receives the news and says, "How can this be? Elizabeth's old. I'm old. How can this be?" Well, you see, he tarried there for a while in conversation with Gabriel. The other priests attending realized that he was going a little too long, like some of my servants. He was going too long. What was detaining him? Had he been smitten? Had he dropped dead in the service? Eventually, he comes out. But out of this conversation with Gabriel, out of receiving this news, well, he couldn't speak. All he could do was gesticulate, wave his hands around, try and indicate this mercy of God. After all, Zechariah's name means remembered by God. God had remembered him and given him this message about having a child. Well, in due course, it became rather apparent, as it does. It became apparent after about 5 months Elizabeth had shut herself up away from public view, and when she emerges, well, it's clear she is with child. Well, this goes on until it's time for the child to be born. And since he couldn't speak, the elders of the community start to say, "What are we going to call this baby?" And Elizabeth says, "His name shall be John." John means preceding, one who goes ahead, one who precedes. And the elders say, "Wait a minute, you don't have anybody in your family named John." The custom was to name somebody, a child, after someone who had gone before, and at last resort, name him after his father, Zechariah. And then Zechariah suddenly regains his voice. After this long period of letting his theology cook, he regains his voice and he says, "This, the last and greatest prophet," Jesus says, "therefore the last Sunday of the year, this is John, the one who precedes." He precedes the anointed one. And then, in this magnificent section of Scripture, he prophesies. He prophesies about what has been the full year and what's coming. He prophesies and he says, "God has looked favorably on his people and has redeemed them." That's the opening promise. As Zechariah claims, he says, "He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David." There is one who is coming who will save us from our sins, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. He has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors. All the promises throughout holy history are coming true. And he has remembered his holy covenant. The deal, the covenant that was made between Abram, who later became Abraham, and all the chosen people of Israel. It's a done deal. It's happening now. It's being fulfilled. That we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him out without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And then it shifts. It goes to, "And you, child, you little baby John, you will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death to guide our feet in the way of peace. All the covenant, all the promises, all of the holy history comes down to this moment now, this season of the Lord, that John is born because God remembers Zechariah and Elizabeth. And John, in turn, prepares the way of the Lord. John will prepare the way for the Jesus Christ, our King of Kings, who will come. The old is being wrapped up. It is being transitioned in John. And with the coming of Jesus Christ, all things wonderful, new, and fulfilling will happen. Why do I choose this passage? I choose it because this week I heard another sermon in Presbytery. And the one point I especially enjoyed was the point that was made when the preacher said, remember that hope does not appear in the rearview mirror of your car. Hope is always ahead. Hope is always ahead of you. We remember on this Sunday that Jesus Christ, our King, is always up ahead of us, leading us, guiding us, and directing us. We remember on this Sunday that because we have a King, we are blessed. And we always have hope. We remember on this Sunday that the covenant promises of God are enumerated and laid out in the prophecy of Zechariah, and then at a pivotal hinge point, it shifts to say, and you. Did you hear that? And you, child, will be called prophet of the Most High. You will go people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of God, the dawn from on high will break upon us, and you are my witnesses. So here we are. Wrap it up in another year. Wrap it up in another full cycle of worship, remembering the entirety of holy salvation. But we have a King. The future is ahead of us, and in that future ahead of us, there is hope. And you and I continue in that prophetic tradition that was established in the last and greatest prophet, John. You and I are commissioned to be without fear, to share the truth, to share the light, to share the story of salvation and forgiveness of sins. You and I are called to prepare the way of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.